pray the prayers, peace be upon all the messages of God, who are the models, human models for human excellence, and demonstrating the guidance for the best way for us to live our life. And we pray for peace upon you, dear learner, watcher, listener. Thank you for tuning in. Welcome to the Happiness Campain with Dr. Z. And I am Dr. Z, greeting you in light, love, peace, and harmony. But today we have a special guest with us, a good friend of mine, a lifelong friend, I would say, Robert P. Kinzer. We know him as Bob. And we want to welcome you to the show, Bob. And we'll have him introduce himself. And thank you for coming.
Hey, it's a pleasure being here, Dr. Z. I just want to say, one, it's an honor for being here. And two, I'm happy to be here.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Well, we expect this is going to be a lively session. And what I want to do is give a little background for some who may be new to the show. And we do really appreciate you being here. Our approach to happiness really, it has more of a spiritual approach. And over the course of the last couple of months, we've seen that Time Magazine came out with a whole article, a whole edition, Bob, on this science of happiness, right? And so what it does is scientifically confirm what we're talking about spiritually. But let me make a couple of opening comments to set the stage, and then we're going to turn it over to Bob and move forward. So happiness is a state of being, and it seems to come and go with different levels of intensity depending on our mindset in any moment of time. And like most people, I've always wanted to be happy and experience it all the time. But it seems that we know what we want. We want happiness, peace, safety, and security. But do we really know how to have it consistently? So back in 2005, I started this journey of research and writing and facilitating learning around happiness. And it's become apparent that many of us either don't know how to maintain a happy state of being or are so heavily weighed down from negative conditioning in thoughts and feelings that we aren't willing to change our habits. So, you know, lifetimes of social, cultural, historical conditioning has crippled the souls, hearts, and minds of humanity all over the world. And it seems that some have lost their human consciousness and replaced it with race consciousness, gender consciousness, age consciousness. We've become so conscious of national origin and religious consciousness, etc. So is it possible that our souls have been corrupted by misperceptions of reality, causing spiritual, moral, psychological, and physical disease? Is highly possible. So what happens is we need to have a way that allows us to get back to this natural state that we were created in. And that's what we're trying to do right now, because we are human beings created by a creator who has a plan for our life. And the best way to live happy is to strive to be God conscious in our mindset. You know, Bob, we talked the last month or so ago about three types of people out of the guidance, the scriptural language. And the first type are those who are God conscious, and they're grateful, right? And they have a discipline in terms of their devotional service. And they also invest from what they've been provided with, which is kind of a money idea. But it's not just money they invest. They invest their time, their knowledge, their energy, their love, all these things, right? The second kind of people are those who are ungrateful, right? Some people are ungrateful. It doesn't matter if you want them or don't want them. They're not going to pay attention to you. Because some
of them.
Huh?
We have a lot of them.
Yeah, you might have been with some of them at work today. You or those of us who are on the show, you know. And so the thing is that because of their condition, their heart has this cover over it and their hearing. So if you can't feel and you can't hear and then there's a cover over their eyes, then it's going to be very difficult to be happy, you know, in the short run, in the long run. Then the third type of people are those who are trying to deceive God and trying to deceive those who are obedient, you know, but they only deceive themselves because something is diseased in their heart. And that disease increases because they lie. They lie. And so, if, and any of us are vulnerable to be in any one of those three vibrations at any moment. That's why we have to be diligent and reflecting on our own behaviors. And then we have to, we always talk about, aligning our vibration with what we want and asking, right, in the positive way. And then allowing ourselves to receive what the spiritual life, what God, what the universe, however you want to say, brings to us. And then take action, and that helps us accomplish what we're here to accomplish. So that's just kind of a backdrop, kind of catch you up with what we've been doing here. And what I'd like to do then is, ask you to tell us who you are and, where you're from and what you're all about.
Well, my name is Bobby P. Kinzer. I'm a Washingtonian from Washington, D.C. Endangered but not extinct, the D.C. man lives. I am a senior financial management analyst at the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, that is the FDIC, the people that insures the money in the commercial bank savings loan, which is approximately $7 trillion, to be exact. I actually am the president of a nonprofit called Life Literacy Institute for Financial Enrichment, and we encourage and promote financial education and economic inclusion in the DMV, in the District, Maryland, and Virginia. I went to Wilson High School, Penn State University, Texas University, and I played professional basketball in Europe for 5 years. And there's a bunch of people actually listening in today from Scotland, England, and Ireland, and Germany, and I just want to say hello to those people because they're just great people and that they're tuning in today. But so I played professional basketball. I came back to the States and I got a job as a stockbroker and a investment advisor. And from there, I became on the regulatory side of banking, which we do, make sure banks are practicing safe and sound practices, following rules, regulations, and compliance with fair lending, Community Investment Act. So I've been heavily in finance. Now I've within FDIC and in my nonprofit, I go around really trying to educate individuals on the importance of making good, sound financial choices, which would invariably lead to them having a better life. That's why actually most people are messed up. It's usually because of, three reasons. Either they fail the plan, they lack information, or they have misinformation. Yeah. And the misinformation a lot of times comes from family and friends who are messed up, trying to tell you how to live your life. You know how you had a guy in school, he got a D, he trying to tell you how to get an A.
Right.
Those are the kind of people. So it ends up people making errors in judgment in their life that end up repeating it and end up with a messed up life. But finance is very important.
Yeah. Let me jump in here for a second because I want to, for those of you overseas, you all know Bob, okay, and you know what he's accomplished over there. I met Bob at Penn State. We were at Penn State together.
Yes.
And we didn't know each other in D.C.
Happy Valley.
Yeah, Happy Valley. It's interesting that I'm the happiest guy.
I
went to school to Happy Valley. There's no coincidence, though. That's how God does things. Just now I can see all these things, but the thing about it is, from Bob's background, he's very accomplished, done a lot of things, and helps a lot of people. So I'm really happy and honored to have him here to help us with our finances. I mean, I got some stuff too, but let me ask you, what extent does conditioning from early in our life around money impact the choices that we make, going forward? In other words, I remember as a kid, I got my little money. I would go spend all of it on candy,
right?
Because that's how it was. And there were conversations in the house about money, shortage of money, and this. How much does that stuff affect us in terms of putting that disease in our heart about money?
Yeah. Well, there's the question that does what you do or do not do with your resources have anything to do with the success in life. And it does. Money is so important. I mean, it's in every facet of our life. And growing up, how we were, we wasn't taught really personal finance, and our parents, you know, they hid how to pay bills, and I don't even know if my mother really budgeted or not. And the only investment, you know, I knew of growing up was life insurance with a guaranteed interest rate, like of, you know, value of 4%, but we didn't even have life insurance. Mm-hmm. So how we grow up, because it's all about a mindset. Mm-hmm. It's definitely a mindset. Mm-hmm. And money is amoral. Really, it's like any other tool. It's not good or bad, but how you use it, it can be used for good or bad. And we've been taught with, like you said earlier, given so many lies about money. We've been miseducated about money. And so it has affected our spiritual walk, because a lot of times people put money first and not God. So one of the first things to getting your finances in order is really putting God first. So a young guy once said to me, "Mr. Bob, how putting God first is going to help me pay my bills? How I put God first is going to put money in my pocket?" And I told him, when you put God first, then you end up having a heart that is more grateful, that is humbled by his provision, and relying upon him for all things, and that the things that he provides or has given to you is really to use for him to advance his glory. So it comes down to your heart. You know, you gotta make sure that your heart is aligned with God and what God wants you to know about money and debt. And growing up, we sort of were taught that, you know, money was separate and God was over here. But if you read any religious book, it speaks about money a lot. And it's not that they're about money, it's just that money is that important. And the education of it in the early, because we used to think to bring financial educational tips to younger people that were like in kindergarten or second or first grade, that used to be taboo because we didn't think they were ready for it. But now, you know, today, introducing just how to identify coins, how to have a piggy bank is so important to the further existence of the education of young people as they grow. Because studies show the more you educate people about finances, the more they grow and they have a desire to go further, and it pours into other facets of their life and school and education. They become more inquisitive, they ask more questions, and it has a lot to do. It has a lot to do with happiness.
Okay, so the question that we want to focus on tonight, and we do have a couple of other questions that you all sent in, which we will definitely get to. But the main question is, you know, how does happiness, right, impact your money, how does money impact your happiness, right?
Right.
Vice versa. Right. So what do you think? Tell us, man.
Well, they're definitely interchangeable, because some people, if you don't have any money, they're not happy.
Yeah, I know when my money gets a little low, I definitely feel a little different in my spirit, in my walk, in my attitude.
Right, and some people, if they're not happy, they can't make money. Mm. Depending, like talking about people who are working in their jobs and get disenchanted and walk off their job because they're not happy.
Oh, man.
But happiness does, they are directly related, because it's a mindset, really. It's a mindset, and it is definitely spiritual, and it depends, it starts with the heart. Your heart is a very essential to your being. And your heart is really essential to where God is. I'm not talking about the heart, the organ. I'm talking about your feelings, your family, the things you treasure, you know, the things that you hit most. That's why it's important that your heart is in the right place, because there was a study done, like you said, right now it's interesting that there's a lot of studies being done, but there was a study done this year by the Gallup polls, the people who do the polls, and it was called the Gallup Global Emotions 2016 study. They studied 140 countries and 147,000 people around the world about happiness. And it came down, like, defined in two ways. it's interesting that some people will see happiness the way they see their life. Mm-hmm. And then some people that see happiness the way they live their life. Okay? And okay. This is the difference.
Yeah.
Like Denmark and Scandinavia, very rich countries, they define happiness the way they saw their life, with things, and how much money they have, and stuff, houses, cars, boats. Where Latin American countries, which were the countries actually that they know that were the happiest, they actually looked at happiness the way they lived their life. The laughter, the smiling, the joy that you have in living it. So that's sometimes how you look at your life, you know, it can affect your money, it affects your relationships, but it's definitely interaction between the two. Mm-hmm. But it's so important that one really has their heart in the right place if you really want to heal, be able to heal. It's, to me, it's a spiritual thing, and it's a mindset. Because it's the thing about Wayne Dyer said, if you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change.
That will change. Yeah, I did a lot of his readings earlier. Do we have a caller for the show, or is this...
I'm sorry, she's trying to watch it online. She's having trouble.
Oh, okay. Help her. Thank you. Thanks for calling in to get, yes, to get some help.
But check out mindset. Check out mindset,
sir, right? Sir.
There was a guy, young guy, playing basketball in his driveway, right?
Okay.
And he lost his contact.
Okay.
He was looking, couldn't find his mother, came out and found it immediately. He said, "Good gracious, Mom, how in the world? I've been looking for this contact. How did you find it so quick?" He said, "Well, see, you were looking for contact, but I was looking for $150. So it's all a mindset, you know?
Yes, sir. That's right. Well, that's true. And you know, there's even a formula. And we've talked about this before. If you want to improve your results, you got to change your behavior positively, right?
Right.
But mindset, skills, knowledge, and specific goals are the formula to help us change our behavior, which we don't normally like to do, so we can improve our results. So please, go right ahead with what your thoughts are. Maybe we should look at one of these questions.
Let's look at one of the questions.
Okay. So we have a question here. It says, what should we know about money that will prevent us from becoming obsessed with having more and more money? So that's one question. And there's two more here, but let's deal with that one.
Okay. Let's deal with that one first.
Okay.
Yes.
Will we repeat it?
No, I got it.
Okay.
Got it. Actually, it's based on what we just talked about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what we need to know about money is that, you know, money is atypical. But how you use it determines how it can be good or bad. So when you look at money, you know, it can actually, you know, it can how you use money brings to the surface who we are and what we believe in. So that's why it's so important that we gotta make sure our heart is in the right place.
Say that again, please. And let me encourage those of you on the show, get a pen and some paper and take some notes. Okay, I brought my notebook and it says every moment counts. Okay, so I'm going to take some notes and encourage you to do the same. Say that one more time, would you please, Bob?
Money is amoral, like any other tool. It's not good or bad, but how you use it can be used as good and evil.
Mm-hmm.
And how we use it brings to the surface who we are and what we believe. So it can be a mirror to look into our souls. Mm-hmm. It can show greed and selfishness, or it can show generosity and altruism. It can be used to further the good news of God, or hoard it for the good news of how much more you have than your neighbor. So how we look at money is so important, but I just can say in a simple way, you must put God first, because when you put money first, you end up with this attitude of entitlement.
Mm.
You end up with an attitude of ungratefulness, and you think that it was all done by your hand, and that causes problems. That causes why people live in confusion, why people have despair, because their heart is not in the right place to be able to deal with money.
Mm. Mm. That's something, isn't it, man?
Yeah. Yeah. So mindset is so important that people understand. It's not about how much money you have. It's not about how many assets you have. The name of the game is that you must control your money and not let your money control you. That is the way to go. And it all starts with a mindset. Because we are taught, like we were saying, that when you're young, you give it. And religious organizations, a lot of times, discourage people to get wealth. Like, wealth is bad. You know, when I grew up, you know, I was taught, you know, oh, no, money is the root of all evil. And actually, the actual scripture says the love of money is the root of all evil.
Yes.
But we've been lied to and misguided, thinking that money is bad. So the question comes up, is money with problems different than having problems with no money? And the answer is, it ain't no different. You still got problems.
That's true.
So, you know, but I must admit, I've never had money and problems with money and no problems.
Yeah,
problems with no money. But it's so important that, you know, we get the mindset. But see, we live in a negative society. That's why a lot of times we don't live in this happiness thing, and we're not grateful with the money we do make. For instance, why does the weatherman tell you it's a 20% chance of rain instead of being positive and telling you it's 80% chance of sunshine? You know, it's these negative things that seep into our mind and trickles down to our heart and makes it hard for us to understand the guidance that God is trying to provide for us that is right there. You know, another one. Okay, we spent the first 2 years, right, trying to teach our kids how to talk and walk, right? And then the next 16 years, we tell them to shut up, sit down. You know, so it's a mindset, man. We enable our own kids at an early age, but we can't be afraid of wealth. You know, wealth is a good thing. I mean, it's not the end all, but wealth actually does create happiness. It's not the epitome of happiness, but I know that when first somebody feels that they can meet their subsistence and make sure their bills are paid, they actually end up more happy.
Yeah,
but it shouldn't be that way. It shouldn't be that way. You know, how you see your life, are you happy? Or how you live your life, are you happy? Stuff and things give you happiness, or the gratefulness that you're just able to have, wake up this morning and be thankful that you can help somebody out, give somebody else a positive word, and move on in this life and get in the flow of the Spirit of God.
Well, you know, it's interesting because one of the things that they say in this Science of Happiness Time magazine is that don't be concerned about spending your money on stuff so much. But spend it on experiences and spend it on other people, right? So there's an underlying law there, right? That if you're spending out of gratitude, because we're still talking about the three types of people, right? If you're spending out of gratitude, then God's going to give you more, you know, because that's just the law, right? You're not losing anything. Matter of fact, the only thing that we have, at least, is what we can give away in this life. Be it money, knowledge, so forth. All
right.
Okay. So where you want to go next, Bob?
What's the next question?
All right, let's see.
There was one about money. When did the money start?
Yeah, that's where we're at. It said, my question is, how did money start in the first place? Because it seems to cause more unhappiness to the lives of people.
Well, that's a very good question because money goes back thousands, thousands of years. It really was more of a barter system, but it became the barter system started having a flaw because, you know, if you had a cow but the man had a fruit farm, you know, if he wants fruit and you just have a cow, the barter ain't going to work.
Mm.
So as time went on, like in the 14th century, actually coins started coming into play. Silver and gold. And gold became more precious than silver, coins. But the coins were so heavy, you know. So England, the Church of England, believe it or not, they wanted to start a bank. Mm. And they started saying, okay, look, we'll take your money, store it for you because it's so heavy to carry around, and give you a note for it. Mm-hmm. But what happened was they were charging interest, which is usury, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And usury in Islam and Christianity is a sin. Mm. People don't realize that. But in both religions, because anytime you charge somebody for something you didn't even work for, you didn't do anything for, that is a sin. That's why it's a sin. So in the 14th century, 15th century, 1400, the king of England didn't want that dirty money. So they pushed those people out, and they didn't have a bank. They said, no, we're not going to deal with dirty money. They went up into Europe. And then the 1600s came, and it was a new king. And check this out. The new king goes, hey, you know what? We don't want to have all that dirty money, but what we want to do is we're going to start the Bank of England. And that was the first bank that was started by the church. Okay. And if you look at that blueprint, some of the mega churches have that same blueprint where, by law, if you have a church, it's nonprofit, a pastor cannot be touching the money or the executive or CEO of the church, right? Mm-hmm. But then they have the profit side where they normally become the CEO, like they'll have their books will go through there, their movies, they sometimes call it senior citizen living. That's the profit side. And it's almost the same blueprint that the Church of England said, oh, we're not going to deal with that dirty money. We're going to put it over here and start the Bank of England, which was the first bank. And that's how money actually started.
So what you're saying that in the religious, because we talk about this diseased ego in all industries, business, education, religion, right, government. So what you're saying is that even though in the scripture language, it talks against usury, the church in England at that time actually started the bank and interest in usury, correct, even against the goddess. So in the three types of people, they weren't being conscious of God in that particular instance.
I would think so.
I would call it maybe of the deceivers and the lying part.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Or even some ingratitude of covering and hiding the guidance.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Because of the money. And we live in a society that is based on this concept of interest.
Yes,
capitalist society.
They're not doing anything for it, they charge you. But, you know, it is so interesting when you talk about how, when you look at history in any book, Bible, Quran, history book, there were people that were lying. One of those people, three people, two people. And some people say, oh man, but the people didn't know. But when you look at it, a lot of times people, because they wanted their fancies, they would let those false prophets speak to them smoothly, and they would speak back to them smoothly because they wanted what they wanted. Even though God had spoke to them and said, no, you need to do this. But they listened to these people. Doesn't that sound like today how some of these individuals are talking smoothly to one population, getting them fired up, getting them feared, getting them believing lies, just to misguide them and really to control them. And money has been doing that for so long. But money should not control your emotions. Money should not have nothing to do about your happiness. That's what I'm trying to get to.
Yeah. No, this is good. This is good. So let me say that if you have a question out there that you'd like to get answered, then you know you can call in 240-455-5934. One other person sent a question in. She has a college fund that she's putting into for her grandson.
Okay.
Right. So her question is if he gets a scholarship. Right, then you know what happens to that fund. What's the impact of the fund on the scholarship or the scholarship on the fund?
Well, it depends on the scholarship. If it's a full scholarship, if it's a partial scholarship, you can still use that money. to fund the part that is being funded by scholarship. But this is a full scholarship, and I don't know what funds he's talking about.
That's why
he's talking about a 529. Let's just assume that's the most prevalent college fund right now.
Okay.
Is the 529, which people will put money in. That money is your money. And if you do not use that money for your kid's college, then that money goes, you just do not, if I hope I'm right about this, so kind of, but you do not get to keep the interest.
Okay.
But you keep your principal that you put in there.
Right, okay. That's fair. I mean, that makes sense to me, you know. Okay. So there was one other part to the first question. Get it, find it here. Now, what we're going to do with our format, I don't see it, I'm still looking at it, but we got about, looks like about 25 minutes left. Let me find this other question. Go ahead.
You know, I find when I go around and teach financial education, it's interesting because I do it for free, but it's interesting that the people sometimes don't come out to the seminars at the churches that I'm doing this at. Uh-huh. And it's one because some people's pride get in the way.
Right.
You know,
right.
They're faking it to make it.
Right.
You know, they're riding around in a Mercedes and they're up to debt. You know what Mercedes stands for, right?
No, what?
Mercedes payments are killing me.
Oh, gosh.
And other times, some people think that it's over their head.
Right.
And then some people are so far in the hole, in debt, they just feel they can't get out. But yes. you can always get out. You know, there are people with retirement who might have waited too late to stash money away, and they may be in their 50s.
Right.
It's never too late.
Yeah. But that's good news. That's good news, because I know I need some help.
Right.
I mean, I'm not what you say, fronting. I need
you're trying to keep 100 like the young people say.
That's right.
But don't be throwing no shade, and I ain't thirsty. I'm
okay.
That was all the acronyms.
Yeah, you have to give me some new language. Help me with the new language. I need some new material.
Quiz that there was. I got a new one, man. I'm trying to keep crystals, man.
Crystals?
Crystals. That's right. I'm trying to keep crystals. You know what I mean?
No.
I'm trying to keep it crystal clear, that's all.
Okay. All right. Well, we need clarity. Yeah, this is Bob. This is my buddy here.
I ain't lying.
No, you ain't. No,
I'm fired up, man.
I know which one of those three people you are.
I'm fired up, man. I'm telling you.
That's how
you said you were going to talk about money and happiness.
Yeah.
Those are the two things I live by.
Yeah.
I love it, man. I'm fired up like a man smoking a cigarette at a gas station. I'm about to blow up. I don't even understand that. Sir, it's all about attitude. Attitude is everything. Appearance is just 80%.
Yes, absolutely. So I know that you got some tips. Let me try one more time, see if I can find this other part of this question, the first question. Or, you know, you could help me out and call in. 240-455. Hold on, it should be here. 455-5934. And look, you don't have to give your name. You don't have to say where you're from. None of that. We just want to... this is a service, you know. This is a service. We're just trying to help.
So we know that the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, CFPB, it was created under President Obama because the credit card industry was regulated.
Okay,
right?
Okay.
And then you always had the Federal Trade Commission that, you know, you had, you know, a consumer complaint. But people need to understand about CFPB. They were created to regulate and look out for the consumer. Mm-hmm. And it's there. You can go consumerfinance.gov. If you have a complaint, they get back to you 24 hours. Any kind of federal consumer complaint, buying somebody deeds wrong mortgage, they're there. They're the ones that actually just fined Wells Fargo $185 million for charging those people setting up accounts illegally. But they came up with a standard definition for financial wellness. Right?
Okay.
Financial wellness is basically, financial wellness is defined as financial security and financial freedom of choice. in the present, and in the future. And let me tell you what that means. Financial security in the present means being able to take control over your day-to-day monthly finances. Financial security in the future means being able to absorb any future shock. If you take care of your finances, and if you manage them properly, it doesn't matter if it's an economic downturn, a recession, a Democrat in, a Republican in, if you take care of it, you will survive. And it's so important. Now, financial freedom of choice, now this is important, because this is a little bit new in this modern day, talking about freedom of financial choice. And freedom of financial choice is simply financial freedom to make choices to enjoy your life. That's financial freedom of choice in the present. Financial freedom of choice in the future is being on track to meet your goals. Being on track to meet your financial goals. So, just want to give people base, because right now there's so many organizations teaching financial literacy, financial capability, financial education, but they try to come with one definition that all can agree on so that you can at least have a starting point on what is financial, being financial stable.
Yeah, well, you gotta have a definition. You gotta understand the nature of things and one of the characteristics of things, right, also. But let me ask you, for those who might want to get in touch with you, and we'll do this again before we leave. Okay. But what, you know, how do kind of people plug into what you're doing to help us?
Well, you can go to our site, Life Literacy Institute Financial Enrichment, under financialenrichment.org, and you can find out about our programs. We do youth investment programs, we do young adults, we do adults, older adults. There's information out there how to find out more. You can call me on 301-237-1632. I said it again, 301-237-1632. And you can email me at bpkinzer, K-I-N-Z-E-R, at verizon.net if you, you know, have any kind of questions.
Say that email again, BP?
BP. Bobby Purnell Kinzer, K-I-N-Z-E-R, at Verizon.net.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now I know that the other part of this, we wanted to leave folks with some practical tips.
Oh, good.
So can we transition into that?
Yes.
And
Yeah, let's do that. I just want to share, since we talk about the spiritual side, we also need to talk about the knowledge side. God wants to know about how to apply the knowledge he wants us to know about money and debt. So I just want to leave you with about a couple of tips. Tip is that, first one is know where your money goes, okay? A lot of people spend money and don't know where it goes. Like that $4 cup that you spend for coffee 5 days a week at Starbucks, that's $80 a month. So you must review some of your items that you spend money on and find the areas where cutting back can move your savings account forward. Number one tip, know where your money is going. Number two, develop a budget. Do you know they did studies and they saw that the average person would rather go to the dentist than create a budget? I think that's so amazing. Most people don't like to do a budget. You know, if you fail a plan, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You plan and fail.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So budget is very important so that you can understand your expenditures. And develop a budget takes it out of your head because most people want to hold it in their head. Mm-hmm. But when you put it down on paper, it crystallizes it. You can see the money coming in, the money going out, and what you have left. So creating a budget is very, very important. Number three, automate your savings. I know a lot of people like say, okay, I'm going to save $200 a month. They put $200 away, and then the next month, they go, well, I want those shoes, George, so I'll put $150, and then the next month, I'll put $250 in. It never works that way. Mm-hmm. But one way it would help you, the trick with financial savvy people is they do automatic savings. They automatically go in out of your paycheck, or out of whatever income that you have an automatic, and that way, it'll grow, because the key is savings. America is at the bottom of advanced countries in savings. I'm talking about at the bottom. Mm-hmm. We know how to make money, we know how to spend money, but we do not know how to manage money. Mm-hmm. Savings is now. This is what we call the richest man in Babylon. Get it? It's great for kids. One of the top things to talk about why people are not rich or wealthy is because they just don't save. So save at least 10%. At least 10%. Do more than that. Here's another good tip. Pay your bills online by using AutoPay. Okay, because that helps your credit. I mean, when I was single, man, I had the money and wouldn't be paid. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, credit will kill you.
Yeah.
You know, your credit is so important now. They look at your credit for a job. They look at your credit for insurance. I mean, it's, they really take this credit thing serious. And you need to. So paying your bills online, being automatic, so you don't have to worry about it. You know it's going to get paid. Have automatic bill pay. But be careful. You must also continue to check that online bill pay, because sometimes, say if you had an insurance policy, the premium went up, and you didn't check the auto pay, you could be short. So just don't rely on technologies solely. Okay?
Yeah.
Next one we'll talk about, pay off your credit cards. Credit cards will kill you. You know, credit cards is like Mexican food. You know why?
Why is that?
It's not your money. I ain't lying. You gotta pay off your credit cards, man, because that debt is what pulls us down. Only 40% of people pay their balances off a month.
Wow.
So it's important that you pay, and this is so important that we get a handle on that credit, because just remember, credit card is not your money. For real, it is not your money. And that's what's really taking a lot of people down. Now, since the economic downturn, right, credit debt is over like $1 trillion. And it increased since the downturn. It's starting to go up, and it's almost at the level before the economic downturn. So people are starting to go back and starting to use credit and get more debt. I can tell you, debt is a killer, and you must get rid of that debt. Protect your credit. This is very important. You must protect your credit. Check your credit report at least once a year. Now, most people don't know that you can get your credit report, a free credit report, three times a year from one from each of the three credit bureaus, Experian, Equifax, and TransUnion, right? Free, and it's called annualcreditreport.com. Now, be careful, because there's fake ones out there called free annual credit report, but it's annualcreditreport.com is free. If you want to protect your credit, this is one way to do it. Don't get all three at once. Get one, because you get one free one each credit bureau. Get one at the beginning of the year, one in the middle, and one at the end. And that way, you can sort of look and make sure people ain't committing fraud. Next one is, you gotta save, y'all, for emergencies. Rule of thumb is 6 to 8 months, but really you can do more than that. But you got to have savings, because there's all kinds of future financial shocks that happen, that come up, refrigerator goes. You just never actually really know. Next one, plan for retirement. Plan for retirement. Let me tell you, most people, this amazes me, man.
Mm-hmm.
I know people that spend 2 years planning their way, they don't spend 2 hours planning their finances.
Mm.
I know people who spend like 4 months, 6 months planning their vacation, and they only spend like 1 hour planning their finances.
Mm.
You got to plan your retirement, and it's important. You can also benefit from, you know, use your 401k plan at your jobs. Please do that. Next, see financial advice from professors. I don't know why a lot of black people have a problem seeking professional advice, but a lot of professional athletes did, you know, where they seek advice from all persons, or they did seek astute financial advice. You need to do that, because those are people that know. And the last one I just want to share with you is keep good financial records, right? You know, utilize online tools as well as copies and receipts to keep your records of your bank information, taxes, insurance, and other documents that is important to your financial situation. Because I know some people, you know, heaven forbid, if you have a person's life is taken away and you don't know where the financial documents are, you fish around. No, you need to make sure you have your financial documents in order. So those are just 10 tips. There's so many more that I wanted to share with the audience out there. There's so many more, but this is the name of the game, you all. You control your money. Don't let your money control you.
Yes. So I'm looking at these 10 tips, and I hope you all wrote them down, because I did. If you didn't get them, you can send me an email, drzhappiness.com. I'll share my notes with you. Maybe we have a caller here. That's a question. So this is really good. In fact, I already know I can see two or three of these. I'm coming to you to help me with, because I need some help.
Right.
Okay. I think we have a caller who has a question. Do we have a question or we just?
Yes.
Okay.
All right.
Excellent. There's a, I think she's gonna put them on so everybody can hear the question.
I'm sorry, miss. Just give me one moment and I could put you on the air so you could ask the gentleman your question.
Yeah. You know, Bob, this hour is going by so fast, man. We just scratching the surface. Yes. We need to get you back.
Hello, miss?
Yeah,
here
TV.
Yeah.
There.
Hello? Paula?
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you now. Thank you for calling in. How can we help you?
Okay, I wanted to ask the question about income or lack thereof of families, actually low-income families, that are they're not making the money to even meet their basic needs. So how can they be helped as far as saving money or just meeting their needs?
Okay, great question. And this is the issue with that. In the economic downturn, when they were saying that unemployment was so high, there were over 3 million jobs available for people who had the wrong skill sets. So for people who have no income, have problems with earnings, and one of the ways is to go out and get a skill set that you can go and get a job that you can increase your income and salary.
Okay, I wanted to ask the question about
That is one of the ways to handle it. I mean, it's not about how much you make, really. It's about how much you keep and how much you manage. But if you are having problems with a low salary, not being able to reach me, you have to do one or two things. You have to, you know, get another job, or you need to go get a skill set that you can get a job that will demand a higher income. And that's been the problem, is people's skill sets. People who didn't have the proper skill set to get the jobs that they need to make money. So in 2020, Dr. Z, they're saying the job, and there's plenty of jobs in different fields, but the jobs in 2020 is going to be in IT, healthcare, and finances.
Yes. So we definitely appreciate you being with us, Bob, and we got about 10 minutes, it looks like. I know there's another show that comes up soon. Tell us again how we can get in touch with you, take advantage of these programs that you offer.
You go out on financialenrichment.org and go out on the Literacy Institute for Financial Enrichment, Life, and find information. We have contact information, and you can find all the programs and things that we do. We do everything from home mortgages, to foreclosure prevention, to financial education. We do about investments. We talk about savings and budgeting, and that's where you go.
Right, you actually help us with these 10 tips that you went through in terms of the programs and what you do with people. Yeah. Okay, well, that's fantastic. So when is the next opportunity coming up? Do you have something planned here in the near future?
Yeah, there are actually a couple of events that we're going to be doing. They're actually private events that people have us come through. But we actually going to have our 13th anniversary celebration at the Woodmore Country Club coming up on October 13th. Mm-hmm. And we are celebrating 13 years providing, you know, people with good, sound information to make better choices in their life.
What do you, that's fantastic. I know, I think, 13th. See if I'm in town. If I'm in town, maybe I can get by. if you want me to be there.
Yeah, well I definitely would like it. Actually, it is invitation only.
That's right. That's why I put it that way.
And you are invited, Dr. Z.
But I don't want to put you on the spot in front of the whole world, right?
That was a given, Dr. Z.
Yeah. No, this is my brother here, and we appreciate you so much. What do you think the possibility of us doing together a happiness and money seminar at some time here? Maybe we can even host it here at the Everlasting Life.
I think that would be great because the two complements each other, man.
Yeah.
You know, actually, I get happy when I talk about money.
Yeah. Well, I get happy when I think about you because, you know, we got this connection. That's, you know, 30-something years.
And we D.C. homies.
Yeah. I mean, it's just amazing. Look at us now, you know. Remember, at Penn State, it's a different world. But we're grateful that we have found our path through studying the knowledge of God and preparing ourselves and finding our gifts and then sharing them with the world.
All praise be to God.
That's right. From now on, forever.
Yes.
So what I'd like to do is a way to kind of close us down. And give us one more time. How do we get in touch with you again, Bob?
I love it. Financialenrichment.org. My number is 301-237-1632. So if you want to email me, B as in Bobby, P as in Pernell, KINZER, BP Kinzer at Verizon.net.
Okay, excellent. And we'd ask you all to give us some more questions if you have for Bob, and we can see if we can get him back here another time. In fact, you know, this is a platform for anybody that has a worthy cause like this, trying to help people. You just need to get in touch with me at drzhappiness.com, and let me also announce that I have I'm going to start another happiness keys to everyday happiness class. It will be a conference call, and I'm looking to start it in October. I haven't got the date set because I need 10 of you all that's listening and interested in this to sign up. You just go to my website, drzhappiness.com, and let me know you're interested, and we can have a conversation about the details, and we can set a date. I know I have one person already that's ready to go, so I just need 9 more folks. Okay, so I want to leave us with this reflection and commentary on appreciation and gratitude. The human being cannot provide for him or herself. The best that we can do is invest from what we've been provided. Actually, no creature in the heavens or earth can provide for themselves. The provider and sustainer of life gives us everything. Therefore, a response of appreciation from us is necessary for a life of happiness and ease. The scriptural language gives us these ideas that happy are those who accept the will of God as the goal of their lives. They live by the phrases, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." They seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. To each of us is given the privilege of walking by faith. To walk by faith is to enjoy the presence of God, as did Abraham and others. The Almighty guides humanity when commanding, "Call me while contemplating at the same time. I will allow your advancement and double it over a long period of time. Keep in mind my grace and its repetitive greatness. Be grateful to me. Do not cause ingratitude by covering, hiding, and negating my blessings upon all of you." God shows us equality, justice, and balance in these instructing signs. It seems he wants us to remember him and what he has commanded of us. His command is to walk by faith, obedience, trust, and gratitude. In return, he will remember you and us and reward and fulfill his rewards of grace and forgiveness. It is the remembrance of God, the reflection, thought, and feeling in the heart that will cause the human being to advance in behaviors and results. Why? Because it is the instructing signs of God as rehearsed by the messengers that purifies us from the diseases in our psychology and our heart and our soul, and teaches us the scriptural wisdom and teaches humanity what we do not know. This is the true education of the intelligence of the brain and the heart. To conclude, thinking on God and feeling gratitude are two priorities for human life and advancement. If we contemplate the signs we are taught in the guidance, then we can fulfill the command to be grateful. Without gratitude, what can the human being have but ingratitude? We can be grateful or ungrateful in any moment, and when we cover and hide God's blessings to us, that is ingratitude. Not giving credit to the source of all blessing negates the benefit. And if one does not have gratitude, he or she cannot have the protection of God consciousness. What is the best way to show gratitude? Isn't it by using what we've been given? We must acknowledge, accept, and appreciate the blessings of God all of the time, even though they're too numerous for us to count them. Otherwise, we slip into ignorance and ingratitude. Seems the best way of expression, of appreciation, is developing and sharing them. As we said earlier, the only things we have is what we give away. And whatever knowledge, skills, time, money, and feelings given to us must be shared, and this keeps things in the balance. So what is the outcome of giving away the blessings of God? When we give them, the one who is truly rich gives us more. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, and shaken together and running over, shall men give unto their bosom. For the same measure that you met out, it shall be measured to you again. The principle of justice requires we develop and share our gifts. Otherwise, we may be in shades of ingratitude. Lastly, the greatest gift to us is human life. If we look at the favors in all aspects of the life, money, spiritual life, mental life, family life, community life, physical life, they cannot be numbered. If you could put on a scale the blessings of eyesight balanced against a lifetime of 80 years of worship, the eyesight would be heavy. So let's remember with gratitude God's favor on us and behave appropriately. I want to thank our guest, Bobby Kenza, helping us with happiness and money tonight. And like I say, we want to check your schedule and see when you can come back. We can do some more things. I want to thank Alisa for the beautiful engineering that she is and does. And I want to thank you all for tuning in again. Join us. Join the campaign. DrZHappiness.com. That's DrZHappiness.com. And we close with this prayer. Our God and evolve, cherish, and sustain. Please accept this from us. For you are the listener and the knower. Amen.